That concludes questions on the statement. We now move to the next item on the order paper, which is a motion on Scrambler and Quad Bikes. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour and 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer for the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. I will ask the clerk to read the motion, please.
That this Assembly calls on the Executive to review the current legislation governing Scrambler and Quad Bikes, and further calls on the PSNI and other responsible agencies to ensure that the current legislation governing these machines is enforced in a robust way.
Thank you. Before we begin, I wish to advise members of the need to take care in their contributions today. I am sure that you're all aware that there are ongoing criminal proceedings in relation to an accident involving a Scrambler bike during the summer. The subject matter of those proceedings is sub judice. I do not wish to inhibit discussion on the motion whatsoever, which clearly relates to a matter of public interest, but I would caution members to be particularly careful, please, that they say nothing in their contributions to today's debate that might in any way prejudice the current criminal proceedings. Éireann Sir Jennifer McCann, Leisín Wallú, a Chorchontasia. I call Jennifer McCann to propose and move the motion.
Can I thank Mr Deputy Speaker for bringing the, having to be able to open this motion. I want to bring this motion to the House today in the hope that all members will support it and that all of us can send a very clear message that we are committed to highlight the dangers of scramblers and quads when they are driven recklessly or in public places, and also to be united in doing what we can to ensure legislation governing these vehicles is enforced in a robust way. There have been a number of adults and children who have lost their lives or have been seriously injured in recent years by these vehicles, and the tragic death of Valerie Armstrong and devastation it caused to her family brought this into the public arena again. And I'm very mindful and I'm taking on board the caution that you said about speaking about this particular case. I have no need to explain to members here of this House of the way in which scramblers and quads are plaguing local communities, as I have no doubt that many of you have seen it at first hand for yourselves or have heard about it from your constituents or people coming to your offices. I want to focus on a number of issues during the debate. Firstly, to discuss what needs to be done to ensure the current legislation that governs these machines is being enforced, and also to look at some of the gaps in the legislation, including those around registration. I also think it's important to look at how we can have an effective public awareness campaign, especially around this time of year in the run-up to Christmas, because very often it's when these machines are bought for children and young people. We need all of us to ensure that parents in particular are aware of the law on scramblers and quads and where they can and cannot be used before they buy them for their children. To turn to my first point, put simply, the current law is very clear, and it is this. In order for a scrambler or a quad to be legally used on the road, they have to comply with the following. The driver has to have a driving licence. The vehicle has to be taxed. It has to be registered with the DVA. It has to have insurance. It has to have lights and reflectors, and it has to have a number plate. The fact is, and I feel it's important to emphasise this point, that the scramblers and quads that we see being driven about in our local communities are vehicles that are intended for off-road use only, and it is illegal to drive them on public roads, on public footpaths, or in any public places such as parks. They are only allowed to be driven on private property with the permission of the property owner. And that is very, very clear. That is the legal status of those vehicles. They also have to be insured and the proper safety equipment worn by the users. And if they are being driven in a reckless way or cause distress or annoyance in any place, the PSNI have the power to seize them. As I said earlier, I have no doubt there are many members in this House today who have either personally witnessed the dangerous manner in which scramblers and quads are driven, or have had constituents make complaints about them. I know certainly in my office I get complaints about them regularly. They can at best destroy green areas and pitches, used by children and young people for sport and activities, and at worst they can destroy lives, and they have destroyed lives. By using them in public places, they are putting pedestrians, including young children, and other road users at risk, but they are also putting themselves in danger. People need to have the confidence that when they report the use of these machines in public places to the police, particularly when they are being used in a reckless fashion that is putting members of the public in danger, that the law will be enforced and the vehicle seized and taken off the streets. And parents too need to be aware of when they are buying scramblers and quads for their children, that they can only be driven on private land where the landowner has given permission, and that the scrambler or quad needs to be transported to and from that designated area and can't be driven on the road to it or from it. I, along with other party colleagues and community representatives, recently have had meetings with the PSNI and the Justice Minister and the Infrastructure Minister, and I'm very delighted to see the Infrastructure Minister here today to answer to this very important motion, and I will look forward to see what his response is. And we went there to see what more can be done to enforce the current legislation, or if there were gaps, what could be done to amend it. And I want to say that we had a willingness on everybody's part, for everybody in those organisations, ministers included, and departments, to work together, and they expressed their willingness to work together to try and solve the issue. For example, on the issue of registration, it has been suggested to look at a scheme which would make it easy to identify who owns a particular vehicle, and even the possibility of marking the machine so that if it was being used in a reckless or nuisance way, it would be easy for the PSNI to identify the owner and deal with it. And I know there are a number of other initiatives that have been brought forward towards raising public awareness about this. Signage is one, and setting out, you know, more information for people, constituents like people that come into our offices, but people out in communities, and how they can actually report them and actually give the information of how they can be used and how they can't be used. There are also suggestions that the Belfast City Council would look at possible sites, designated sites and areas for these vehicles where young people particularly could ensure, and that their parents could ensure, that they're being used in a responsible and safe manner. I know this has happened in other council areas, and there has been partnerships of the police, motorsport and community representatives have came together to look at this. And you know, I would hope that Belfast City Council in particular, because I know this is a particular issue in certain parts of Belfast, but I would hope that the council would take that forward. I look forward to hearing what all members say during this debate, and particularly I look forward to the Minister's response. But I have to say, I really, really want to see members supporting this motion, because the truth is, we really need to do something before another tragedy occurs. We need to remove these vehicles from our streets, from our public roads, our public parks and other public places. We need people to be able to be safe, to walk on their own footpaths and to walk in parks. And you know, I want to urge all members to support this motion, and for all of us to work together with all the agencies, all the departments and all the other organisations concerned. Mr Speaker, I put the motion to the House. Thank you.
I call William Humphrey, Chair of the Committee.
Thank you very much, Mr Deputy Speaker. And I rise as Chair of the Infrastructure Committee, but the Committee hasn't met to discuss this issue, hasn't taken a position on it, so these views are entirely my own. I should make the House aware. Mr Speaker, for me, and I agree with much of what the member bringing the motion to the House today has said, and I welcome the opportunity to debate the issue. For me, it is about not preventing people enjoying scramblers or quads, but it's about using scramblers or quads in a safe and responsible way and striking that balance. As the proposer of the motion has said, I receive quite a number of phone calls to my office around this issue, in particular from the expansive Glencairn Park. And the issue there is that some people, particularly elderly people, are frightened when they hear scramblers and the noise that comes and the noise pollution that comes from scramblers in use. But there is a very clear danger on the road. There's a danger to the person using the scrambler. There's a danger to the person who is actually walking on the footpath. And there's, of course, there's a danger for other people in the traffic. And of course, there is considerable damage caused in the churning up of our parks and our pitches. And indeed, in this city, Belfast City Council has spent a considerable number of millions of pounds over the last number of years with its pitches strategy of putting new pitches in place. And some of those pitches, unfortunately, have been damaged because of scramblers. But as I've said, I think it is vital that we strike a balance and a reasonable approach in terms of protection and responsible usage. I think the focus of this House has to be on the protection of life, reducing injuries, particularly serious illness, and reducing road traffic accidents, protecting public amenities, and preventing the destruction of our parks. It's not about making scramblers illegal, but it's about making scramblers and those who use them. And I think, in most cases, it is for the parents of the people who use the scramblers to be responsible and adhere to the law, because it's about protecting everyone. And I do think there's absolutely a need for a joined-up approach around this issue. And from my perspective, as the DUP spokesperson on this particular issue, I welcome this motion, and the Democratic Unionist Party will support a review of the current legislation. I think it's a vital move forward that we would work with local councils, because so much of this illegal activity happens in council facilities, not just in this city, but across Northern Ireland. And so therefore, I think, if I may speak as a Belfast representative, it is important that Belfast City Council looks at the possibility of establishing a facility for scramblers and quads to be used. I remember a number of years ago when I was a member of Belfast City Council, working with young people who were using skateboards and having a skateboard park built underneath the flyover at the Lagan Bridge, which actually took them away from using the skateboard facilities and other public spaces and removed them from being a nuisance to having a legitimate activity on a designated area. And I think that's the approach that should be taken. And I do think, therefore, there needs to be a joined-up approach. And the other issue, of course, is the police. And if the police are seen to be chasing someone on a scrambler or on a quad, they're not allowed to do that in a built-up space because of the potential that would cause for an accident to occur. And I know only last year there was a similar type scenario that unfolded across the way from my office, so someone came out of Woodvale Park. And I mention Woodvale Park because my office overlooks Woodvale Park, and I worked very hard to secure over £2 million for Woodvale Park and with the local community. And some of the pitches that were put there, two new pitches that can be used, are now being used, thankfully, by local football clubs, have been damaged by the use of scramblers. And so I do think there's an absolute need for a joined-up approach and a round-table discussion, and I would very much welcome and support such a call. And I know personally, I have attended the funeral since I've been elected as a public representative of two young people. One of them as young as four, killed on scramblers. One in the mid-shankle, and the other young fella in Ballysillan, who came from Glenbrin, and he was only 14. But of course, the incident and the accident, and I'm mindful of what you said, is Valerie Armstrong. And I would appeal to this House to support this motion, and let's get a joined-up approach and make sure we get legislation that is actually practical and will make a difference and protect lives out there. Thank you.
I call Doug Beattie.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise in support of this motion. In doing so, I stand with our executive as they attempt to curb this menace, which is neither new or unique to Northern Ireland. But I'll do so at the same time challenging our executive to produce more than the words of this motion and look at the problem with a strategic eye. The issue of quad bikes or scramblers driven on our streets in a dangerous manner or on private land without proper personal protective equipment has been highlighted for over a decade, and legislation is in place to deal with it. It's whether or not that legislation is enough. The Road Traffic Order 1995, which was amended in 2016, and the Criminal Justice Order 2008, gives the PSNI the powers they need to ensure mechanically powered vehicles are not driven anywhere other than on roads, and there is an issue with private land. It gives them the powers to seize vehicles used in a manner that causes alarm, distress or annoyance, and finally the power to enforce the wearing of PPE, personal protective equipment, in the form of protective headgear. Last month, and this is interesting, last month the Justice Minister made it clear that the PSNI were content with the present legislation and the powers available to deal with this issue. So in my contribution, I want to raise a number of other issues that might fall out of that. First of all, enforcement. If the legislation is in place and the PSNI are content with the powers available to them, why do we see such terrible incidents as the tragic death of Valerie Armstrong in Colin Glen Forest Park, or indeed, if we reach back slightly to 2011, the tragic death of Daniel Mooney, only 12 years old, when he fell off the back of a Scrambler. Many of these incidents could have been prevented if the PSNI had reacted to reports from concerned residents, because concerned residents are ringing in and reporting these incidents, or if the PSNI had more of a footprint in these areas and other areas in the form of robust neighbourhood policing. Of course, this is not a criticism of the PSNI, because we all know the strain at present on our police force in the form of budget cuts, indecisive strategic leadership and a series of manpower deficiencies. So again, I call on the executive to look at the minimum manning level of the PSNI and take action to increase its numbers to the 7,500 officers as envisioned in Patton report, giving the force the ability to return to fully resourced neighbourhood policing. And with that, I call on the Justice Minister. Yes, of course. Yes.
Member for giving way. And I have sympathy for the point the member makes. However, I would say, does the member agree that ultimately the responsibility is with the parents to ensure that those young people who are using scramblers in an irresponsible way? Police obviously aren't in the equation, but as you will well know, police are always under huge pressure in terms of their time and resource. Like all crime, they have to respond with the resource they have available to them.
Member's next minute.
Thank you. I thank the member for his intervention, and I think you're absolutely right. And later on in my contribution, I'm actually going to raise that very issue. So I call on the Justice Minister to drive forward at pace review of sentencing to enable our judges and magistrates to deliver punishments that act as a deterrent. Because it's not enough for people to use scramblers and quads in an illegal manner and then say they didn't mean to harm someone. By using these vehicles in an illegal way, they are going out knowing that they could end up harming or killing somebody. And then we get on to the parental control. There is without a doubt a trend that those riding quads and scramblers illegally are either young adults or children. Therefore, there is a huge onus on parents to show responsibilities. Parents should not buy their children quads or indeed scramblers unless they know they have access and permission to use private land. Even then, I would ask that they supervise those individuals and ensure they know how to operate the vehicle efficiently and wear the correct PPE. In this, I can see how new legislation making all those who operate such vehicles in private land having to obtain some kind of mandatory formal familiarisation training and a wider understanding of the issues surrounding the use of quads and scramblers. And I think that is something that could help. It is also a reasonable assumption that those parents living in heavily built-up areas who allow their children or teenagers to go out with such vehicles must know they are operating them illegally on the streets or the nearest piece of West Ground. In doing so, those parents are complicit if somebody is to be injured, and they need to be told this. And we need to have proactive measures, because all too often we debate these issues after the fact. And we are debating this today because of a death. So we're debating after the fact. And I do not blame purely the doer of departments of justice, past or present. I don't blame the Justice Committee. I don't blame law enforcement. I don't blame the Assembly. But we must find a mechanism to keep the citizens of Northern Ireland safe. On this particular issue, I have to say there is no easy solution. It is difficult to catch those involved in using scramblers and quads outside legal guidelines. Whatever route we decide to go down, legislation, technology, public awareness or education, the bottom line is we must resource our police service and we must educate our parents. Thank you.
Here, Sir Alex Atwood. I call Alex Atwood.
First of all, Jennifer McCann and others for bringing this motion to the House today. And whilst the motion is clearly important and welcome, everybody is very mindful of the circumstances, the particular circumstances that brought about this particular debate at this time, the tragic and sad and painful circumstances around the death of Valerie Armstrong and the impact upon her family, immediate and extended. But as other members have indicated already, there have been a number of other deaths arising from the use of these sort of bikes and many, many serious injuries. If you do any review of source material in respect of these matters, you will find that on a very regular basis, on this island and in Britain and further afield, there are regular incidents leading to serious injury, if not death. And therefore, it should be within the grasp of all of us, including government, in order to scale up multiple interventions in order to mitigate the risk of death and serious injury when it comes to the use of quad and other off-bike mechanisms. So in that regard, trying to identify remedies and solutions to the problem that is very much clear before us, I could refer to some matters, some of which has been touched on already. First of all, I want to acknowledge the work of Belfast City Council and people involved in community safety over the last number of weeks in order to work up some management tools, for want of a better word, in order to deal with the use of these vehicles. And there are proposals forthcoming in respect, as Ms McCann referred to, in respect of signage on council property, on lampposts, and on private land with the consent of the landowners. And those sort of interventions, in order to issue warnings as to what is or is not allowed, and to issue warnings about what penalty will arise for misuse, I think are going to be important. Could I agree with some of the comments of Mr. Beattie? I do think that given the very heavy risk that exists and the consequences on too many families in this city and beyond, then there should be exhortations upon parents, not least in the next 2 and 3 months in the rundown to the Christmas season, to not buy. And if people do buy, then to put on constraints in terms of responsible use of these sort of vehicles. If there is a need, Mr. Deputy Speaker, for new law in respect of registration and marking of the vehicle of these sort of vehicles once sold, then the SDLP would endorse that. But I think that the experience of people and vehicles generally suggests that there is going to be a need for legislative intervention. That's what we have discovered in respect of all other sorts of vehicles and all other sorts of issues in respect of roads and road and land safety. And my own view is that the new law is going to be required in order to try to manage and manage the issue and then mitigate the risk. Could I also concur with the views that have been made in respect of enforcement? There is a wide family of legislation already in existence. And noting the comments made about police resources, there are a large mechanisms available to the PSNI and other authorities in order to deal with use of these vehicles. There is legislation for use without lawful authority. There's legislation in respect of alarm, distress and nuisance. There's legislation in respect of criminal damage. There's legislation in respect of supplying petrol to persons under the age of 16. And in that regard, there's an obligation upon those who sell petrol to behave more responsibly when people come to their premises. So there is a wide range of enforcement mechanisms and legislation, and I would urge the police to deal with that. One example, Mr Deputy Speaker, and I'll bring my remarks to
a close. Would ask the member to bring his remarks to a close.
Recently in Kent, there was an effort to deploy legislation against wrong use. 94 vehicles were seized, and calls were reduced by three quarters.
Okay. Éireann Sir Trevor Lunn, I call Trevor Lunn.
Gormay Agat, last time quietly. Thank you very much, Mr Deputy Speaker. This motion is timely, and I thank Ms McCann and her colleagues for bringing it to the Assembly. I think the law around the use of scramblers and quads is indeed confused, and also I think there are questions to be asked about the current legislation and the extent to which it is being enforced by the PSNI in particular. If we just take off-road use first, for a start, there doesn't appear to be any restriction on the size of a machine or the age of the person operating it if they are off-road. It is theoretically possible, therefore, for a 13-year-old to be driving around on a 650cc machine as long as they're off-road.
Member for giving way, and I'm sure the member will be well aware through the very high-profile media attention of the very tragic death of young 13-year-old Daniel Sheridan in East Derry, in McGillig in particular, in August this year. It was an incident that really shook the whole community, and I would agree with the member that although motocross tracks may encourage more responsible use of these vehicles, I would encourage that, but would the member agree that it is of the utmost importance that health and safety should be paramount for all riders, especially young people, and on any controlled or purpose-built tracks, and that as such should be included with any review of the use of these vehicles?
Members, an extra minute.
I think I deserve an extra two, Mr. Speaker. I agree with the member's comments, yes. When he talks about health and safety, I could point out at this point in time, my understanding of the current law, again, is that there is no requirement on the driver of a quad bike to wear a crash helmet. There is for motorbikes, but not for a quad bike. The police certainly have a difficulty, because if the equipment is being used off-road, again, they have to be certain for a start that the landowner doesn't want it to be happening there. It hasn't given us permission. It's not easily obtained. And the law they have to try and implement is actually the law of trespass, in my understanding. Trespass, perhaps, according to my basic knowledge, means there has to be damage being done, not just presence on the land, but that's the type of thing I think that the purpose of the motion is to try and tidy up some of this. I mean, theoretically, there could be a noise nuisance complaint made, but that would have to be involve a local council. I mean, try getting the local council to enforce a noise abatement order and see how far you get. This is going to be in the open air, in the countryside probably. It's just not feasible. There's no requirement at the moment for liability insurance if the vehicle is being used off-road. Of course, there is. I'll come to it now in terms of on-road use. And the law there is reasonably clear. These things are regarded as motorised vehicles. They have to be type approved, they have to be registered, they have to be MOT'd if necessary, display number plates, reflectors, indicators, and they have to have third party motor insurance. And this is perhaps where I can contribute something, because trying to get motor insurance, third party motor insurance on these contraptions is actually very difficult. It's a very specialised market. The companies that will insure them, for a start, they're not very keen to insure a quad which is only being used purely for recreational use. This is why farmers don't have any great difficulty in getting cover, because they have a clear need in terms of their occupation. Perhaps somebody could come up with it, maybe they want to draw a boat out of the water or something like that. There are situations where it's possible to prove to an insurance company to have a need for the cover and a need for the vehicle.
Would the member get
away? Yeah, sure.
Agree with me that insurance could be very problematic for anyone to take on. Firstly, because many of those using it are using it illegally in public areas. But secondly, frequently they allow many of their friends, who of course would not be insured, to use the bike, and therefore it defeats the purpose.
Yes, I thank the member for that. If you, Mr Speaker, go and try and insure a 500cc motorbike and you're 17 years of age, you won't get covered. It's not available. The same thing applies to quads. So not only is there a problem over the fact that insurance is required, it's actually impossible to get. And I mean, other members have made the point. Now, we're talking about youngsters here most of the time. And if you see a quad, I'm only really talking about quads here. If you see a quad being driven on the public road by somebody 16, 17, 18 years of age, it is absolutely certain that it doesn't have proper third-party motor insurance. The police seem to be reluctant. That they do have seizure powers, but they don't seem very keen to use them. It's a mess, but it's a mess that needs to be tidied up and quick, Mr. Speaker.
I'd ask the member to draw his remarks to a close.
The police are quick enough, and I've seen them on Twitter proclaiming the fact that they've seized a very expensive motor vehicle because it didn't have any insurance. I've yet to see the same situation arise with a quad.
I call Pam Cameron.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to speak on this important matter today, and thank the proposal for motion for bringing it forward to the House. Just in the back of Mr. Lund's comments there, he referred to helmet wearing of quad bike users, and as far as I'm aware, it should be covered now under the Road Traffic Amendment Act for Northern Ireland 2016, which we dealt with in the last term in the old Environment Committee. So whether that has royal assent yet or not, I'm not sure, but if it's not already in, it's on its way, just by way of information. But anyway, as members have already alluded to across this chamber today, and what I suspect is really the catalyst in bringing this to the House today, is of course the tragic death in July of mother of three, Valerie Armstrong. And it really does bring into sharp focus the need to look at the legislation and the enforcement currently in place. I'd just like to take this opportunity to add my condolences to Mrs. Armstrong's family at this point. Whilst Mrs. Armstrong's death is the most recent and harrowing such event, this is not an isolated incident. Our hospitals are dealing with dozens of cases each year where, on the whole, younger people are making poor choices, ignoring the law and putting their own and others' lives at risk. I fully appreciate the use of scramblers and quad bikes used in an appropriate manner with the correct safety equipment can be a very enjoyable activity for those involved. And I'm aware of a number of purpose-built facilities across Northern Ireland where scramblers and quads can be used in a controlled environment. And for many, it is an exciting pastime. However, as with any activity involving powerful and fast vehicles, there are inherent risks which are often heightened, and these vehicles are, especially when these vehicles are used in an inappropriate manner and safety is disregarded. Quads and scramblers in particular are not toys. They are restricted to off-road use only, and only on private property where permission has been granted. The PSNI have powers to confiscate any vehicles which are using a public or which are causing a public nuisance being used on the road without insurance or without a driving licence. I believe that the root of the problems we see with these vehicles is down to the lack of enforcement of the current powers. The unlawful, aggravating and at times intimidating use of these vehicles is quite often viewed in the context of antisocial behaviour, and quite rightly so. I do feel, however, that there may be an attitude amongst individuals who are using quad bikes and scramblers illegally, that they can deliberately flout the law as nothing will be done. My feeling is that a robust and swift enforcement is key to getting the message across that this behaviour is simply not acceptable. There is, of course, room for improvement in awareness of what the law actually states too. While some are mindful that they are acting illegally in the use of these vehicles, I would suspect that a greater number do not actually be aware of the consequences. Working in conjunction with local schools is something that may assist the PSNI in getting the message out there and educating young people, not only the law surrounding quads and scramblers, but also the dangers that they hold and what can happen if they are used irresponsibly. Finally, Mr Deputy Speaker, we cannot overlook the role of parental responsibility in ensuring that these vehicles are used legally. Again, I feel that there may be a lack of awareness amongst parents of the full intricacies of the laws surrounding quads and scramblers, where they can be used and who can use them. I believe there may be an opportunity in conjunction with the Department of Agriculture, Environment and Rural Affairs to include quad bikes and scramblers in their programme of road safety awareness schemes. In closing, there is no doubt that this is a problem which needs to be addressed, and by vigorously enforcing the legislation, we have an opportunity to raise awareness of the law, and I think we could quickly see a change in the illegal use of these vehicles. So, at this point, can I thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker, and I support the motion.
Éirim Sir Raymond McCartney. I call Raymond McCartney.
Agat Alaskan Kuragas Gwyn Bwegas La Jennifer McCann Haig Togwyl and Molly Shaw of Scorin Antonio New. Thank you very much, Deputy Speaker, and can I thank Jennifer McCann for bringing this motion today to the Assembly. I think we all know, and our people have referred to the death of Valerie Armstrong, and I know Jennifer McCann played a significant role in highlighting the issues which flow from that. Very, very mindful and conscious of the issues which you related to in terms of sub judice. And I know Jennifer McCann has raised this at the, at the policing board and has carried out a number of meetings with senior members of the PSNI in relation to the legislation. I think the motion in itself sets it out very, very clearly, and it's in two parts, that there should be a review of the current legislation, and then it calls on the PSNI and other agencies to, if you like, affect the current legislation in a robust way. And I think that's what we have to do, because I think, and when you come at this issue, and there's no doubt that recent death and it being raised at the policing board brings to the fore many, many issues which sometimes even the public don't understand in relation to particularly what quad bikes and scramblers. And you do have a situation where they have to be taxed, registered and insured. And I think it's in those three areas that more could be done to ensure that people who have these vehicles for, you know, illegal, illegitimate, you know, sometimes even the young people themselves don't understand that they have to have the vehicle registered, taxed and insured. And I think we need a public awareness around this to ensure that that is brought out to the fore. So as when people are buying, and even the point of sale, it's like when you register a motor vehicle, the certainty of the carriage has a relationship to ensure that they inform the DVA if someone has purchased the vehicle. There's responsibilities put on the owners of vehicles to ensure that when they sell a vehicle on, that they have a responsibility to inform the DVA as to who the next owner is. So it's issues like that when we look at the current legislation and then we seek from the PSNI how they enforce it, then I think the review of the legislation will be better informed, because sometimes there is enough legislation in place, its enforcement, its awareness and its relationship between the PSNI and the community. Because in recent times in Derry, and it was in relation to a spate of car crime in the areas where in a combination of stolen vehicles or runarounds, there was great nuisance being caused in some of the estates in Derry. I was involved with a meeting with the PSNI locally, with the Community Safety Partnership, and many of these issues came out. And the PSNI actually did a presentation, and they talked about they actually had seized a number of scramblers and quad bikes, and people in the meeting asked on what basis we were able to do that, because people were working from the if you like, the perception that first of all had to be reported, and then the PSNI would have to nearly catch the person on the scrambler for it to be seized. And the officers involved in the meeting said they went to the house. The person couldn't prove they own it. They couldn't produce insurance, or they couldn't produce tax, and the vehicle was seized. So that's the type of thing which we need to see happening. That's a relationship between the community and the PSNI. So and we all know it, and sometimes it can be seasonal. Sometimes it can be in the summer when younger people are off school. I don't want to say it's all younger people, because I've seen people in my own particular area, and they're certainly not children, it can be around Christmas time where parents think it's not a bad thing to buy a child a small quad or a scrambler. But if they're not tax registered, if they're not given the proper equipment and the proper circumstances, then they're leading them into not only danger, but certainly into a situation where they could get a criminal offence or worse. So I think in terms of the current legislation, I think we have to see it being brought out, brought to the fore, an awareness campaign. I know Belfast City Council, I know Derry City and Strabane Council has done great publicity around the issues of quads and off-road vehicles. The review, in my opinion, will assist the process if they are, and Alec Atwood mentioned that, you know, in his opinion, there may be a need for some legislation. I think he talked about the experience in Kent, and I think those type of instances need to be brought to the attention of the department and the minister. So when we act to assist the process, but I think what we also have to concede is that there is enough legislation in place if there's good cooperation and good enforcement to protect us from us. I'll ask my
call. I call Paul Girvan.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I too stand to support the motion as put forward today, and I don't think there's anybody in this chamber who has not been contacted by people who have either had problems associated with scrambling and the noise and nuisance and all of those areas. And to say that there is not legislation, there is some legislation there which covers many areas of this, and I think it's something which we have to be very aware of. It's just ensuring that that legislation is properly enforced and imparted to those people. But we live in a society where people, unless you legislate for something, they want to blame somebody for doing it. Genuinely, there is personal responsibility and there is parental responsibility. This is two areas that I do think have a vital role to play within this problem which we have, to ensure that those parents who decide to purchase a scrambler for their child and say, without consideration of where they're going to use it, and also without instruction about how to use it safely. And people have made mention about personal protection equipment that they should be carrying or wearing along that. And I think that really reflects to some people believe that if you have a helmet on, you are invincible and you can do whatever you want. Well, I do think that there has to be a consideration as well about those landowners whose land is being used, and sometimes without their permission. And I think primarily of a site within my own constituency, which is currently owned by the Northern Ireland Housing Executive, quite a large area, and it has been used by scramblers and those involved in it. And being a young boy at one time myself, thoroughly enjoy anything associated with an engine and a bit of fun. I don't want to be legislating that we're going to say the Health and Safety Executive get the name of being the Department of No Fun. Well, I do believe that there needs to be a little bit of a give and take on that matter, but I do believe that the Housing Executive have a responsibility to ensure that their land is not accessible and used. Now, that can be very difficult to police. We each and every one have a responsibility to that. And I know the site that I'm talking about, the individuals who live around it, would on many occasions lift the phone and phone the PSNI about it, and to hear the usual story. Unfortunately, we cannot respond to this matter, and unless they're causing a major problem, we'll be out at some stage, but we'll not make it a priority. So as a consequence, it usually happens to come out at 10 o'clock at night whenever there's nobody there, so therefore it's not an issue. But I do believe that we have to ensure that that happens. There is also an issue about those who fall off. If they're on private land and a landowner has not necessarily given responsibility, he does and could end up becoming liable for a minor who gets injured on his land. And that is something which is a very, very worrying point from a landowner's perspective. And it's something that we should be looking at to ensure. And this is where I think that we have to not always throw the baby out with the bathwater, because unfortunately people believe that if you have somebody who's breaking into your property and they cut themselves while breaking into your property, they might necessarily take a claim against you because your property's insured, but they weren't. And by right, and I'm not so sure, and this is where I think the law sometimes can be an ass, because really they sometimes err on the side of those who are perpetrating and creating a problem. But I understand the number of high-profile cases that brought about this debate today, and I think of the case that was mentioned here this morning or this afternoon in relation to Valerie Armstrong and the tragic death. I think that there's also an area that people maybe are not aware of. It's something which is used. Pedestrians are getting told to get out and take exercise. Likewise, young people are told that they need to get outside instead of playing on their Xbox and doing all those things. I think that that's vitally important. But the problem is that those who are on mountain bikes are also in the same predicament, where they're interacting with pedestrians, and it's to ensure that we have that separation between those using equipment and those who actually are pedestrians on public pathways, and I think it's something that we should be looking at as well. So I support the motion as put forward, and I do think that a review would be very helpful.
I call Roy Beggs.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Can I also thank the member for West Belfast for bringing forward this motion? It is an area that continues to give concern, and I agree with her. This is very timely, because some parents, I'd say in their lack of knowledge, may be thinking of making a purchase before Christmas. And really, it's important that people are fully aware of the law and the dangers to both their child and the public from their child who might be renting such a vehicle. And as long as they do so in that knowledge and have somewhere safe in which their child can ride, that would be fine. There is similar concerns in my own constituency of East Antrim of the legal use of motorised vehicles. And indeed, sadly, there's also been a fatality in Carrickfergus in the past. But as I say, there is a need for better informed public in terms of both use of quads and scramblers. I don't think anybody else has outed themselves as a former scrambler. I am. I rode a trail bike from the age of 16 on my father's farm, and then had an RM125. Not everybody fully understands the power that's there. I had a look online, and it's listed as being 38 horsepower. The Yamaha YZ was only 33 horsepower, so it was. But would you dream of putting a child in behind a team of 38 horses? That's the amount of power. They can frequently out-chase or out-ride a car, such as the acceleration. Parents need to understand the degree of power that they're handing to their child. There needs to be education, there needs to be training. And until someone reaches that, it is unwise to hand such a vehicle to a child. But I fully understand the thrill and lucky to have survived the spills involved. And I think it's important that people understand the danger, both to the rider, but also to those in the vicinity. And I noticed just this summer, the police in my constituency have highlighted concerns that have been given to them in the Selby Road, Marshallstown Road and College Walk area of Carrickfergus. And indeed, I've come across scramblers before at the Woodburn Reservoirs, and also at the public park, the council park at Broadlands. So frequently they're being used in either on the road illegally or in public areas illegally. And both cases, parents really should be known, and I suspect there's a lack of knowledge, that there are perhaps £1,000, £2,000 investment, perhaps even more with a modern bike, could be seized from them. So apart from endangering their child, the public, they may lose their precious asset. So there needs to be greater knowledge of that law. The law actually says that anyone with a motorised vehicle more than 22.5cc, and that's very, very little, is classed, their vehicle is classed as a motorised vehicle. Therefore, if they want to be on a road, or it should be insured, it should be taxed, it should have lights, there should be a helmet, and failure in any of those areas, it could easily be lifted. And if it's in a public area without permission, straight away, there's a legal act occurring, and the police, having given a warning, can seize that vehicle. I think we may need to look at the law in that regard to see if there's lessons that need to be improved. This is a very difficult area to police. Are the police to give chase to a young person on a scrambler? Will that involve a high-speed chase, perhaps an accident? That doesn't work either. So we need to see what is practical and what would work. There's mentioned earlier on about creating a bespoke track somewhere. That's a good idea. I like that idea. Again, in my youth, there was a track at Carntall in Newton Abbey. Fantastic. Jumps in midair, you thought you were wonderful. But I would say that in order to facilitate such a track, there's huge risks involved. Will everyone entering that accept their risk and not turn around and sue either the landowner or the council? That needs ironed out. Also, how are such bikes to get to the track? Is everyone, I would not wish parents to think this is coming shortly and without considerable expense. To get to the track, a parent will probably need a trailer, I don't know, £300-£400, a tow bar for their car, £200-£300. So on top of a bike, if they're going to get the bike to the track, they have to be prepared to purchase that. And on top of that, they're going to both deliver their child and collect them later. So it's not just as easy as building a track. I would encourage people to contact local motorcycle clubs where those who are already using motorcycles safely and with some knowledge could give some advice and perhaps some training. Thank you.
I call Paul Frew.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I rise to support this motion and thank the member from West Belfast for bringing it forward. Like West Belfast, my own constituency of North Antrim has been plagued by this activity also, and more so in Ballymena, in built-up areas of the town. But before I move on to that, let's talk about the actual motorsport. The motorsport itself is a very good one. It fascinates young and old. It gives people a buzz and an interest, and that should not necessarily be that should be encouraged. In fact, and young people with interests is a good thing, and hobbies that gets them out and about and gets them off their Xbox is a good thing and should be encouraged. But with that comes responsibility. That is a motorsport. And motorsport is dangerous. It comes with risks. There's high speed involved, and people can get hurt, and people can be killed. And we've had evidence of that only in the last few weeks with unfortunate young Daniel Sheridan losing his life in an accident that was some way controlled. So it is dangerous. And that should be a red light flashing and a siren going off to all parents who purchase scramblers and quad bikes. And that's the first thing we have to say. Even in a controlled setting, even when there's marshals, when there's regulations, when there's laws of a course or a track or a race, there are still dangers and risks involved. How more so then when these young people go out and about in bikes that strung together, on footways and highways where there are people, young people riding their tricycles on footpaths, or elderly folk going to do their shopping in the local shop. That's what's happening. In Ballymena and in Harrieville and in Ballykeel, two distinct areas, built-up areas, divided, of course, by the Larne Road link, which is basically a dual carriageway. There are underpasses, and these young people, not maybe even so young in some occasions, they ride from one area to the other. They use the underpass, which is connected, of course, with a network of paths. They get so far, and they're all heading to the one place, either to the south of the town or to Education Authority land in Ballykeel. So they have to use the network of paths, they have to cross over roads, and then they have to drive down built-up areas, and they drive recklessly down on footpaths, on roads, which have 90-degree bends, to get to their desired environment. They have no permission in either site to ride these scramblers, but they do it thinking that they're doing no harm. But they're doing tremendous harm to the communities for which they sail through. Elderly folk are frightened. Young people are frightened to go out on their tricycles and bikes, and parents are scared to allow their children out. These people drive and ride their scramblers. They do willies down main avenues. They bounce off and on footpaths. It's absolutely no way to treat their community. Some of these bikes are strung together. Some don't even wear safety gear. Do they not realise the danger to themselves, let alone the community from which they live, and the pedestrians and the walkers? They also use an area, a public park called Ecos Centre, where there are many walkers, many runners, and many people out enjoying the environment. And they will swing round those paths that are only a metre wide, and they have little regard for what's round the corner. I do believe this issue can be resolved with better enforcement. I do believe there's times when the police look sympathetically on the actions of young scramblers, because if they're scrambling about in waste ground, well, then they're not out and about doing other things. I think that's totally and utterly the wrong message to send out. I think these bikes can be seized, and I think that would send a warning to the others that this cannot be tolerated. Why do we set laws? We set laws to protect people, but also to change the mindset of society. This is what needs to be happening. The police needs to enforce this better. The police needs to seize these bikes. Thank you.
Éireann Saoire Nicola Mallon. I call Nicola Mallon.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. On Tuesday the 19th of July this year, as many members in this House have referred to, Valerie Armstrong, a devoted mother of three, described as a generous, kind and loving person who was filled with life and the natural appreciation of a young mum by her parish priest. She lost her life after she was struck by a scrambler. Mr Deputy Speaker, as other members have pointed out, we have lost a number of people across different constituencies as a result of the dangerous and irresponsible use of these vehicles. And I think it's important to take a moment just to extend our sympathies to those who have sadly lost a loved one in this way. In recent years, Mr Deputy Speaker, we have seen a rise in the dangerous and irresponsible use of quads, scramblers, go-peds, buzzboards and mini-motors, not least around Cave Hill Country Park and Marrowbone Park in my own constituency of North Belfast. And accordingly, there has been an escalation in the number of injuries inflicted by these vehicles. And I therefore thank the members to my right for bringing this motion before us today. I share the view of Ms McCann that it is important for this House to send a strong and united message of responsibility to parents who often buy these vehicles and to their users of these vehicles. And it's also important that we send a strong message to the PSNI and other responsible agencies that they need to robustly enforce current legislation. Equally, there is a responsibility on the executive working with those agencies to ensure that the legislation is as effective as it can be. Ms McCann has very helpfully taken time to outline the conditions and legal requirements which must be met in respect of ownership and use of these vehicles. The critical point, and nearly every member has touched on it, that we must get across is that these vehicles are not toys. They are motor vehicles. They can travel up to 60 miles per hour, and they can kill, and they should be treated as such. This is the unequivocal message that we must get across, particularly as Christmas approaches. Yes, when used in a controlled, safe and responsible environment with necessary training, they can be fun. In agricultural settings, as Mr Beggs has pointed out, these vehicles are often critically important in carrying out farming duties, for example. But outside of this structure, they can be devastating. And there is much more work that is required to educate parents in particular of the legal requirements and the dangers of these vehicles, and to encourage their safe and responsible use. And there is a role to be considered for other more robust measures when parental culpability is evidenced. And I say that in no way lightly, but to reflect the seriousness of this matter, because the seriousness of it does come home when people are injured or tragically killed. And it also comes home, Mr Deputy Speaker, when you speak to the many residents, and the numbers are increasing, whose lives are blighted by the noise, the disturbance and the risk of injury and death from vehicles driving on our roads, and I have witnessed that with my own eyes in North Belfast, and also in our public parks, which are there for us all to enjoy and to use safely. As many members have articulated, the solution to this escalating problem lies not in one source. We certainly need more robust enforcement of current legislation, not least, I would argue, in PSNI seizures. But this House needs to be able to satisfy itself that the legislation and other tools at the disposal of the PSNI, councils, courts and others is as effective as it can be. Not, Mr Deputy Speaker, that I am suggesting that this would be the case, but the review of current legislation must not be a paper exercise and no more. If this review finds that more is required in terms of legislative interventions, then the Executive should not be found wanting. But the game changer here, I believe, Mr Deputy Speaker, is in raising awareness of the dangers, in promoting the legislative requirements that parents and others who purchase these vehicles must follow. Addressing the issue of parental responsibility is never an easy thing, Mr Deputy Speaker, but it is something that we certainly shouldn't shy away from, not least on this matter. Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker.
I call George Robinson.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. Deputy Speaker, I welcome the opportunity to speak in this very important debate. In my own constituency in recent years, there have been incidents of death, noise pollution from scramblers and quad bikes. It is a problem which householders and others find disruptive and intrusive, and they do realise that a balance has to be struck between the illegal usage of scrambler activity and the legitimate users. The incidents have occurred both on private land and public roads, so there is a difficulty in tracing offenders. The police play a vital role in combating the problem, so when the problem exists, the police need to be more proactive, as they were in Limavady recently. It is forbidden by law to ride scrambler or quad bikes in public spaces, such as playing fields or public parks. Therefore, it is essential that any problem with them is tackled immediately by the police. In July this year, the danger of the misuse of scramblers or quads was brought into sharp focus when, with the recent tragic death of Valerie Armstrong, this family are living with the reality of scrambler and quad bike misuse, and I do realise that this is a very sensitive and legal issue presently. At this stage of my contribution, could I express my sincere condolences to the bereaved families of Valerie Armstrong and indeed the recent death of Daniel Sheridan in the McGilligan area of my constituency on a quad bike. Sadly, this is not the only family in Northern Ireland who have had to deal with accidents from these bikes, and it would be ideal if the number of incidents could be further reduced. For this, there is a need for robust enforcement, as the motion states. Mr Deputy Speaker, to ensure that the legal framework is fit for purpose, a review into the current legislation would be helpful, and possibly identify areas where the law needs to be changed. I would support this review, as the law needs to be fit for purpose. The law also has to be enforceable. Mr Deputy Speaker, it is also worth noting that if the law is to be enforced, there must be enough police officers or other agency officials to be able to enforce the law equitably. Mr Speaker, I support the motion, as it could be beneficial in reducing accidents involving these machines. Thank you, Mr Speaker. I support the motion.
And quad bikes, and I call the Minister for Infrastructure to respond to the debate.
And can I use this opportunity to thank Ms McCann and her colleagues for bringing this very important motion to the floor today. I think the fact that we do not have a divided House, that it seems that voices from all corners of this chamber speak in unison, that there's an acknowledgement that there is no particular silver bullet in regards to this issue, and that we need to work together from all sides and from all corners and on all forums, is a positive development. At the outset, I also wish to add my sincere condolences to the family of Valerie Armstrong, who sadly lost her life after being struck by a scrambler. Her needless death leaves three young children without their mother. I believe that all of us in this House must consider how best to take action to ensure this type of tragedy never happens again. Under current arrangements, my department's remit extends to the regulation of on-road vehicles only, but as Minister for Road Safety, I welcome this opportunity to take a lead role in this debate and share the concerns of those MLAs who have brought this issue to the floor of the Assembly. We need to do all in our power to tackle what appears to be a growing problem. I am prepared to play my part, and I believe that an overwhelming number of members of this House also feel the same themselves. The law as it stands is relatively simple. If you wish to use a scrambler or quad on the public road, you must have an appropriate driving licence and insurance, and the vehicle must be type approved and meet necessary safety standards. It must be registered and display a number plate, and you must have paid your vehicle excise duty. If you cannot fulfil these conditions, you may use the vehicle on private land if and only if you have the clear permission of the landowner. You may not ride the scrambler or quad in parks, on footpaths or on land belonging to any public body. I understand that the PSNI consider that current legislation provides sufficient powers to take action against those who illegally use scramblers or quads off-road, but the difficulty lies in detecting and catching offenders. I have recently met with Ms McCann to discuss the issue, and I am aware that she has also met the Justice Minister to voice her concerns. It is clear that, whatever the legislation might say, we have a growing problem with the illegal and anti-social use of these vehicles. They are being imported in increasingly large numbers and can be bought cheaply. Many are being bought by parents for young children. The problem is not limited to the north of Ireland, and I have looked across these islands to see how other jurisdictions are indeed dealing with it. The legislative framework is broadly similar in the south and in Britain. On-road use is regulated. Off-road use is only with the permission of landowners. Media and newspaper reports make it clear that effective enforcement is an issue for all of us in all of these jurisdictions. During my meeting with Ms McCann, we discussed the introduction of a registration scheme for these off-road vehicles, in effect extending the current scheme that exists for on-road motorcycles. The potential advantage of registration at the point of sale would make it clear, particularly to parents, that such vehicles are not toys. It would enable us to monitor the number of vehicles in circulation and easily identify owners. However, it is unlikely to resolve the practical problems around enforcement. The introduction of such a scheme would require powers that have not been devolved to the Assembly. I am aware that in Britain several attempts have been made to introduce legislation to require all off-road motorcycles to be registered. As this is an accepted matter, these proposed schemes would have to be extended here. All of these attempts have faltered, mainly, it seems, due to the failure to address the enforcement issue. The Association of Chief Police Officers does not believe a registration scheme would be viable. This is because there is not an established, reputable dealer network to ensure registration at the point of sale, and because identifying marks can be easily removed from the vehicles themselves. The Motorcycle Action Group and the Motorcycle Industry Authority also believe that a registration scheme would be unworkable and that the real issue is the lack of enforcement of the current law. Against this background, I am unconvinced that the answer lies solely in legislative change. Nevertheless, I would not rule it out at this stage and will keep the legislation available to us under review, and I am happy to work with members and communities to strengthen the legislation that we have at our disposal. It is also important to bear in mind that the success of any legislative change would depend on our ability to use it to change behaviours. Traditionally, this is achieved, at least partly, through enforcement, and I note that this motion calls upon responsible agencies to ensure that the current legislation governing these regimes is enforced in a robust way. Under current legislation, PSNI has the power to seize and dispose of vehicles and to prosecute riders for a range of road safety offences. In certain circumstances, parents and guardians can also be reported for prosecution or issued with a fixed penalty notice. Prelaskincolia, I have already held a brief discussion with the Justice Minister, who shares my concerns and determination to take some positive steps to address this matter. We discussed a number of potential options, and we are keen to explore these further in the months ahead. One particular area that could be addressed immediately is education. Realistically, we cannot have a police officer on every corner. Enforcement is important, but the PSNI cannot do this alone.
Minister, for giving way, can I just say on that very point, I agree entirely with the Minister. It cannot be something, and a number of members made reference to the police, cannot be something which the police can tackle and address on their own, because there is an issue of resource and enforcement and so on. I welcome the Minister saying that he's had a joint meeting with the Minister for Justice around this issue. I think the only way we can actually tackle this is if there is a round table and there's a joined upness across government here, but also I think with local councils and the police, take this forward. The Minister welcomes such an initiative.
Thank the Chair of the Committee for the remarks, and indeed this is going to have to be done in partnership, not just between MLAs and government, but of course our local councils, who very often are the landowners and control the land a lot of this is taking place in. So certainly I'm more than happy to work in conjunction with the Justice Minister and with local councils as we go forward. Therefore, at my meeting with Ms McCann and my meeting with the Justice Minister, we also discussed the development of an awareness campaign. I note that the Police and Community Safety Partnerships have already taken a step in this direction with the publication of an advice and information leaflet that sets out the law in this area. It also contains a section aimed at parents, and I think this is vitally important. All too often, parents buy these vehicles for their children without giving any thought to where and how they will be used. These vehicles are not toys and, as we have seen, can be a lethal weapon if not used considerately and in line with the law. I would like to widen this awareness effort and will work with the Justice Minister to explore what we can do jointly around the development of a campaign targeted at parents who have or may be thinking of purchasing a Scrambler or Quad for their children, particularly as we run up to Christmas. I am also keen to raise awareness that this is a community issue and that we can all help to make a difference. If you see someone riding one of these vehicles illegally, please call 101 with a description of the bike and the rider. Those who are breaking the law in this manner need to realise that their neighbours will not tolerate this sort of antisocial behaviour. A free last concordia in conclusion, the use of scramblers and quads as a leisure activity can be both exciting and fun. There are a number of clubs and societies across the north which can give out information about where to pursue the hobby lawfully and safely. People need to stop taking risks with their own lives and those of the community around them. We must not lose sight of the pain and suffering caused by those who use these vehicles illegally without any thought of the consequences or the concerns for others. We need to take action to address this matter now, and I will do my part, and my department will do our part as we do this. Gormila Mugget.
I now call Fra McCann, Éireamsa or Fra McCann, agus bé gén no méid agat, you'll have 10 minutes to comment on the motion.
Actually glad that my colleague Jennifer had brought this to the floor of the House. I think that it's something that in many areas right across the North has been on the minds of many people over a lengthy period of time. And just before I go in to speaking about or relaying what people had said about the thing, and we're coming into a period just in the run-up to Christmas again, and I think it was mentioned earlier on, where parents will be actively looking and coming under pressure from their children to purchase these machines for Christmas. And I remember about 3 or 4 years ago in my own community going on to the front of the Falls Road on Christmas morning and hearing the bikes and quads coming along the Falls Road, and there was a number of young people, I think it was about 11 or 12 of them, and it was like a youth chapter from Hell's Angels coming down the thing at high speed. They're a novelty in many communities, Christmas Day, Boxing Day and after, while some of them end up disappearing in the sheds and cupboards. There are many more who will have had serious accidents, will be brought to hospitals with arms broken, legs broken, whatever else. But there will also be pedestrians who may suffer being run over by these machines. One of the things that hasn't been mentioned, and well, it's not a new phenomenon in the terms of death driving. You know, even last Saturday, a young man in my own constituency was attacked by three people and had his bike taken off him that was used to drive at high speed around the areas, putting people's lives at risk. This is becoming a never-increasing problem. And I know that people are saying that there's legislation, obviously, for theft, but there's also the fact of life is that this can happen day and daily within communities. And I think when the Minister spoke, or he spoke about education, and that's a crucial thing. If parents realise that they have to, that there has to be a licence, if parents realise that they have to have insurance, if parents realise that there's all the additional costs attached to this, many would have second thoughts and ban these machines for their children. Sure, but just to start that, when Jennifer spoke. She spoke about the number of adults and children who have lost their lives over a period, and said that there needs to be more awareness of from parents on the laws that are out there. She also talked about the impact well-run and designated sites could have on it. William Humphreys spoke, and he's speaking personally about some of the stuff that has happened within his own constituency. He emphasised that this is not about stopping people enjoying scramblers, but dangers on the road for pedestrians, and the focus of this house should be on protection of life. Council needs to look at some facility provided by council or whoever. Doug Beattie said supports the motion. There is legislation in place, but doesn't know if it is being implemented to the full. Police say that there is enough powers, and yet there are still deaths occurring. Judges need to take stronger action and stronger legislation. Alex Atwood said everyone understands the circumstances which brought this motion to the chamber. He says we also need to mitigate against future deaths and injuries. He commended Belfast City Council for some of the stuff that they are doing, and the need for legislative intervention and new laws are required. Trevor Long said the motion is timely. Laws need to be revised. Questions need to be asked of the PSNI. No requirements on people to wear helmets when driving quads. Tom Cameron said quads and scramblers, when used properly, can be enjoyable for people. The root of the problem is that the use of legislation or not being used properly. A robust implementation of the power would help. Raymond McCartney stated that Jennifer had raised this issue at the policing board, and over this past couple of months she has been fairly robust and raising this issue time and again. He said that the legislation needs to be done in a robust manner, or used in a robust manner, that we need to speak to the PSNI to find out how they would enforce any new legislation. And he went on to describe in his own constituency how the police had seized scramblers and quads in his own community. Paul Gervin said many of us have been, contacted about the misuse of these bikes. There is a parental responsibility when banning these scramblers. We need to understand the problem and the ability, also the difficulty that there is where landowners who may not know that people are using their land illegally, and they could find themselves in serious problems if somebody is seriously injured, or worse, while doing that. Roy Beggs said some parents may be ready at this time of the year to be contemplating banning a quad or a scrambler. They need to think and understand the serious consequences. Paul Frew said his constituency of North Antrim has been plagued with the same problems others have, and even in the controlled setting, these machines are dangerous. People drive recklessly on footpaths and built-up areas. Nicola Mullen said a number of people have lost their lives or rather been run down by these machines outside controlled settings. These machines can be devastating in terms of deaths and injuries. Enforcement needs to be robust. George Robinson said police need to be more protective, and this activity has been brought into focus with the death of Valerie Armstrong. And the Minister finally said, laid out the legislation. He said the PSNI have said there's enough legislation there to deal with the problem. Detection is the problem, enforcement also, but he does not rule out legislative change, but education is crucial. And there seems to be that running through, obviously the protection of life, the education of parents. And I think what William Humphreys has said and others have said here today is that maybe between us all, we can find something there that will allow us to effectively deal with this growing problem. Thank you.
The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye. Aye. Contrary, no. I think the ayes have it. The ayes have it. The next item on quad bikes, and I call the Minister for Infrastructure to respond to the debate.
And can I use this opportunity to thank Ms McCann and her colleagues for bringing this very important motion to the floor today. I think the fact that we do not have a divided House, that it seems that voices from all corners of this chamber speak in unison, that there's an acknowledgement that there is no particular silver bullet in regards to this issue, and that we need to work together from all sides and from all corners and on all forums, is a positive development. At the outset, I also wish to add my sincere condolences to the family of Valerie Armstrong, who sadly lost her life after being struck by a scrambler. Her needless death leaves three young children without their mother. I believe that all of us in this House must consider how best to take action to ensure this type of tragedy never happens again. Under current arrangements, my department remit extends to the regulation of on-road vehicles only, but as Minister for Road Safety, I welcome this opportunity to take a lead role in this debate and share the concerns of those MLAs who have brought this issue to the floor of the Assembly. We need to do all in our power to tackle what appears to be a growing problem. I am prepared to play my part, and I believe that an overwhelming number of members of this House also feel the same themselves. The law as it stands is relatively simple. If you wish to use a scrambler or quad on the public road, you must have an appropriate driving licence and insurance, and the vehicle must be type approved and meet necessary safety standards. It must be registered and display a number plate, and you must have paid your vehicle excise duty. If you cannot fulfil these conditions, you may use the vehicle on private land if and only if you have the clear permission of the landowner. You may not ride the scrambler or quad in parks, on footpaths or on land belonging to any public body. I understand that the PSNI consider that current legislation provides sufficient powers to take action against those who illegally use scramblers or quads off-road, but the difficulty lies in detecting and catching offenders. I have recently met with Ms McCann to discuss the issue, and I am aware that she has also met the Justice Minister to voice her concerns. It is clear that, whatever the legislation might say, we have a growing problem with the illegal and anti-social use of these vehicles. They are being imported in increasingly large numbers and can be bought cheaply. Many are being bought by parents for young children. The problem is not limited to the north of Ireland, and I have looked across these islands to see how other jurisdictions are indeed dealing with it. The legislative framework is broadly similar in the south and in Britain. On-road use is regulated, off-road use is only with the permission of landowners. Media and newspaper reports make it clear that effective enforcement is an issue for all of us in all of these jurisdictions. During my meeting with Ms McCann, we discussed the introduction of a registration scheme for these off-road vehicles, in effect extending the current scheme that exists for on-road motorcycles. The potential advantage of registration at the point of sale would make it clear, particularly to parents, that such vehicles are not toys. It would enable us to monitor the number of vehicles in circulation and easily identify owners. However, it is unlikely to resolve the practical problems around enforcement. The introduction of such a scheme would require powers that have not been devolved to the Assembly. I am aware that in Britain several attempts have been made to introduce legislation to require all off-road motorcycles to be registered. As this is an accepted matter, these proposed schemes would have to be extended here. All of these attempts have faltered, mainly it seems due to the failure to address the enforcement issue. The Association of Chief Police Officers does not believe a registration scheme would be viable. This is because there is not an established, reputable dealer network to ensure registration at the point of sale, and because identifying marks can be easily removed from the vehicles themselves. The Motorcycle Action Group and the Motorcycle Industry Authority also believe that a registration scheme would be unworkable and that the real issue is the lack of enforcement of the current law. Against this background, I am unconvinced that the answer lies solely in legislative change. Nevertheless, I would not rule it out at this stage, and will keep the legislation available to us under review, and I'm happy to work with members and communities to strengthen the legislation that we have at our disposal. It is also important to bear in mind that the success of any legislative change would depend on our ability to use it to change behaviours. Traditionally, this is achieved, at least partly, through enforcement, and I note that this motion calls upon responsible agencies to ensure that the current legislation governing these regimes is enforced in a robust way. Under current legislation, PSNI has the power to seize and dispose of vehicles and to prosecute riders for a range of road safety offences. In certain circumstances, parents and guardians can also be reported for prosecution or issued with a fixed penalty notice.
Prelasconcolia, I have already held a brief discussion with the Justice Minister, who shares my concerns and determination to take some positive steps to address this matter. We discussed a number of potential options, and we are keen to explore these further in the months ahead. One particular area that could be addressed immediately is education. Realistically, we cannot have a police officer on every corner. Enforcement is important, but the PSNI cannot do this alone.
Minister, for giving way, can I just say on that very point, I agree entirely with the Minister. It cannot be something, and a number of members made reference to the police, cannot be something which the police can tackle and address on their own, because there is an issue of resource and enforcement and so on. I welcome the Minister saying that he's had a joint meeting with the Minister for Justice around this issue. I think the only way we can actually tackle this is if there is a round table and there's a joined upness across government here, but also I think with local councils and the police take this forward. Do the Minister welcome such an initiative?
Thank the Chair of the Committee for the remarks, and indeed this is going to have to be done in partnership, not just between MLAs and government, but of course our local councils, who very often are the landowners and they control the land a lot of this is taking place in. So certainly I'm more than happy to work in conjunction with the Justice Minister and with local councils as we go forward. Therefore, at my meeting with Ms McCann and my meeting with the Justice Minister, we also discussed the development of an awareness campaign. I note that the police and community safety partnerships have already taken a step in this direction with the publication of an advice and information leaflet that sets out the law in this area. It also contains a section aimed at parents, and I think this is vitally important. All too often, parents buy these vehicles for their children without giving any thought to where and how they will be used. These vehicles are not toys and, as we have seen, can be a lethal weapon if not used considerately and in line with the law. I would like to widen this awareness effort and will work with the Justice Minister to explore what we can do jointly around the development of a campaign targeted at parents who have or may be thinking of purchasing a Scrambler or Quad for their children, particularly as we run up to Christmas. I am also keen to raise awareness that this is a community issue and that we can all help to make a difference. If you see someone riding one of these vehicles illegally, please call 101 with a description of the bike and the rider. Those who are breaking the law in this manner need to realise that their neighbours will not tolerate this sort of antisocial behaviour. A free last concordia in conclusion, the use of scramblers and quads as a leisure activity can be both exciting and fun. There are a number of clubs and societies across the north which can give out information about where to pursue the hobby lawfully and safely. People need to stop taking risks with their own lives and those of the community around them. We must not lose sight of the pain and suffering caused by those who use these vehicles illegally without any thought of the consequences or the concerns for others. We need to take action to address this matter now, and I will do my part, and my department will do our part as we do this. Gormila Mugget.
I now call Fra McCann, Éireamh Saoirse Fra McCann, agus bé Jen Nóméid agat, you'll have 10 minutes to comment on the motion.
I'm actually glad that my colleague Jennifer had brought this to the floor of the House. I think that it's something that in many areas right across the North has been on the minds of many people over a lengthy period of time. And just before I go in to speaking about or relaying what people had said about the thing, and we're coming into a period just in the run up to Christmas again, and I think it was mentioned earlier on, where parents will be actively looking and coming under pressure from their children to purchase these machines for Christmas. And I remember about 3 or 4 years ago in my own community going on to the front of the Falls Road on Christmas morning and hearing the bikes and quads coming along the Falls Road, and there was a number of young people, I think it was about 11 or 12 of them, and it was like a youth chapter from Hell's Angels coming down the thing at high speed. They're a novelty in many communities, Christmas Day, Boxing Day and after, while some of them end up disappearing in the sheds and cupboards. There are many more who will have had serious accidents, will be brought to hospitals with arms broken, legs broken, whatever else, but there will also be pedestrians who may suffer being run over by these machines going speed. One of the things that hasn't been mentioned, and while it's not a new phenomenon in the terms of death driving, you know, even last Saturday a young man in my own constituency was attacked by three people and had his bike taken off him that was used to drive at high speed around the areas, putting people's lives at risk. This is becoming a never-increasing problem. And I know that people are saying that there's legislation, obviously, for theft, but there's also the fact of life is that this can happen day and daily within communities. And I think when the Minister spoke, or he spoke about education, and that's a crucial thing. If parents realise that they have to, that there has to be a licence, if parents realise that they have to have insurance, if parents realise that there's all the additional costs attached to this, many would have second thoughts in buying these machines for their children. Just to start that, when Jennifer spoke with a number of adults and children who have lost their lives over a period, and said that there needs to be more awareness from parents on the laws that are out there. She also talked about the impact well-run and designated sites could have on it. William Humphreys spoke, and he's speaking personally about some of the stuff that has happened within his own constituency. He emphasised that this is not about stopping people enjoying scramblers, but dangers on the road for pedestrians, and the focus of this house should be on protection of life. Council needs to look at some facility provided by council or whoever. Doug Beattie said supports the motion. There is legislation in place, but doesn't know if it is being implemented to the full. Police say that there is enough powers, and yet there are still deaths occurring. Judges need to take stronger action and stronger legislation. Alex Atwood said everyone understands the circumstances which brought this motion to the chamber. He says we also need to mitigate against future deaths and injuries. He commended Belfast City Council for some of the stuff that they're doing, and the need for legislative intervention and new laws if required. Trevor Long said the motion is timely, laws need to be revised, questions need to be asked of the PSNI, no requirements on people to wear helmets when driving quads. Tom Cameron said quads and scramblers, when used properly, can be enjoyable for people. The root of the problem is that the use of legislation or not being used properly. A robust implementation of the power would help. Raymond McCartney stated that Jennifer had raised this issue at the policing board, and over this past couple of months she has been fairly robust in raising this issue time and again. He said that the legislation needs to be done in a robust manner, or used in a robust manner, that we need to speak to the PSNI to find out how they would enforce any new legislation. And he went on to describe in his own constituency how the police had seized scramblers and quads in his own community. Paul Gervin said many of us have been contacted about the misuse of these bikes. There is a parental responsibility when buying these scramblers. We need to understand the problem and the ability, also the difficulty that there is where landowners who may not know that people are using their lawn illegally, and they could find themselves in serious problems if somebody is seriously injured, or worse, while doing that. Roy Beggs said some parents might be ready at this time of the year to be contemplating buying a quad or a scrambler. They need to think and understand the serious consequences. Paul Frew said his constituency of North Antrim has been plagued with the same problems others have, and even in the controlled setting, these machines are dangerous. People drive recklessly on footpaths and built-up areas. Nicola Mullen said a number of people have lost their lives or rather been run down by these machines outside controlled settings. These machines can be devastating in terms of deaths and injuries. Enforcement needs to be robust. George Robinson said police need to be more protective, and this activity has been brought into focus with the death of Valerie Armstrong. And the Minister finally said, laid out the legislation, and said the PSNI have said there's enough legislation there to deal with the problem. Detection is a problem, enforcement also, but he does not rule out legislative change, but education is crucial, and there seems to be that running through, obviously the protection of life, the education of parents, and I think what William Humphreys has said and others have said here today is that maybe between us all we can find something there that will allow us to effectively deal with this growing problem. Thank you.
The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye. Aye. Contrary, no. I think the ayes have it. The next item.